Hello, I'm here at Orchard Gardens, and Farmer Clare is right behind the camera. And I just wanted to say a quick hello to the posse before, and let you know that I'm here, not the voice, I'm the voice behind the camera, Genevieve. I'm the outreach director for Garden City Harvest and one of your CSA guides. And I'm gonna flip it around so that there's Clare.
Hi.
And she's gonna be teaching us about fermentation today. Take it away, Clare. Clare's been doing this for a while now.
Yeah, so I'm Clare, as Jody said, I'm a manager at Orchard Gardens. This is my first year managing out here, but this is my fifth year working with Garden City Harvest. And I started kind of experimenting with fermentation a couple years before I started working here, mainly with like sourdough and kombucha, not vegetable-based ferments. But once I started working here and started having a lot of cabbage, which I had never really been a part of my diet before, I started getting interested in vegetable-based ferments. And of course, the easiest way to jump into vegetable-based ferments, in my humble opinion, is a simple sauerkraut. It's super easy, and that's what I'm gonna show you how to do today. And this is nice because it's kind of a basic recipe and you can kind of go wild with it. So, sorry. I am gonna wash my hands. You just need cabbage, you need salt, you need a jar, and that's about it. You can kind of take off from this recipe, and I like to add other vegetables. I like to add like apples and onions. You can go wild with the spices, whatever your heart desires. Once you kind of get the basic recipe down, it's very easy to riff off of that and do a bunch of other stuff with it. So, like I said, you need cabbage. Here's some cabbage. You need some salt. So I'm gonna wash this cabbage off really quick, wash my hands.
Right.
And we'll get started.
While you're doing that, Clare, I'm gonna quickly say this space that we're in is the Orchard Gardens barn. You can see behind us. This is a homeward constructed spot. It's affordable housing for folks, and it's a whole complex. And when they built this affordable housing, they also decided to put a garden slash farm here at Orchard Gardens. It was originally going to be a parking lot, and they decided instead that they would build, since this is a neighborhood, it's in the Orchard Homes neighborhood, that they would build a garden, because it's such a big part of the history of the neighborhood, that they would build a garden instead of a parking lot. And they put the parking lot underneath this it's the apartment buildings that are next door to this barn. And now we can use it as a community barn for things like cooking. Okay, back to Clare.
All right, so we've got cabbage. The first important thing about making sauerkraut and really making any type of fermented thing is that oftentimes it is really important to pay attention to ingredient amounts. And so the key with sauerkraut is that there's a ratio of vegetable matter to salt that you have to use in order for it to like ferment the right way. You can use less salt, like you don't necessarily need salt to ferment anything, but it's gonna take longer, it might be like a little different in flavor, and you shouldn't be afraid of salt. It's an important part of this. So, first thing you need to do is know how much cabbage you're using. So I just have a scale right here, so I'm gonna pop it on. And this is about a pound of cabbage. I'm gonna make a pretty small batch here. So what you can do if you don't have a kitchen scale is when you acquire your cabbage, whether it's at CSA, the grocery store, the farmer's market, whatever, just weigh it there so you know about how much you're using. You are gonna like tear out the outer leaves and core it. So it's nice to have just a cheap kitchen scale, especially if you're gonna get into fermentation because you are doing a lot of measuring. So I just have like, this little guy. And this was probably like $15. And yeah. Pretty easy to get, pretty easy to use, but you do need to know how much cabbage you have. So once you have your cabbage and you know the weight, you're gonna tear out the outer leaves and try to keep at least one of these outer leaves like semi-intact. I'll tell you why later. So like that. If there's any other gross stuff going on, tear it up. So what I tend to do is just kind of go like that. And you have this wedge with the core left, and then most of what's in here is fine. And then I'll do that over here too, even though I didn't get very much core in. And then you're just gonna slice your cabbage. So I like a pretty thin slice for my sauerkraut. Mm-hmm. It's really up to you, depending on what texture you're into. Some people like just do big wedges and let it break down. Other people like chop it. It's up to you. I tend to just do slices, kind of like I'm making coleslaw. So yeah, just thin ribbons.
That's what I do too. I like it nice and thin. I do think having a good cutting board and a good knife is always two of the basics for CSA success.
Get a sharp knife.
Get a sharp knife.
This knife is not that sharp. But yeah, your life will be a lot happier if you have a sharp knife.
It doesn't even, I mean, it's nice that it doesn't even, you don't have to buy one of the super fancy ones. You just have to make sure your knife stays sharp. Although, and I don't want to put down, the nice fancy ones are really nice.
Yeah. It's a good, like, birthday or Christmas gift. Really nice knife.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I have a little bit of green cabbage, too. So I'm just going to throw this in. You can do it with red cabbage. You can do it with green cabbage. You can do it with Napa cabbage. You can do it with anything. If you're using the purple cabbage, your green cabbage is going to get stained with purple by the end of it. Everything in your jar is going to be purple, but, you know, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It's tasty.
So you want to make sure you get to a pound?
Yeah, that... this cabbage, I think I said this cabbage was a pound. It was actually 2 pounds, so I'm only going to do about half of it.
Okay.
Because I'm going to use this green cabbage too, but...
It sounds like it's all about the ratio of salt.
Yeah, you can do as much
cabbage.
As little vegetable as you want, as long as you get your ratio right, which I'm going to go over in just a sec.
I know I was afraid of fermentation for a long time because I was afraid of all the bacteria and the good versus the bad. And then once I finally did it, it wasn't quite as scary as I thought it would be.
It's really easy. Okay, so this is about a pound of cabbage. I'm gonna get wild with a little bit.
Woo!
Throw it in here too. This is where there's like some, you know, some people, if they're adding other vegetables or fruit or whatever, put it in here at this point before they start to like macerate the cabbage. Some people wait till after it's macerated and all wet to do it, but I don't think it really matters. I think that if you do it at the beginning, that like gets the flavors kind of mixed together a little bit more, but I do usually wait till the end to put in any spices I'm using. But yeah, so I'm gonna put in...
What is macerate?
Macerate is like, I guess that's not the right word actually, because I think that's like when fruit like sits in its own juices and gets all like wet. But I don't know what to call this.
Massage? Is that what?
Massage of the kale. Or the cabbage. Which I'll show you.
I just heard you use that word before.
Yeah. Basically, when you mix the salt in with the cabbage and mix it up, it gets like, it starts releasing a lot of juice, which is part of the process. And so what I'm saying is that like some people add in other vegetables before you do that mixing process, mm-hmm. and some people will wait till the end. I like to do it at the beginning, so I'm going to add a little bit of carrot right now. I would prefer this to be a little bit less, or a little bit less finely shredded, because I kind of like it to hold up a little bit more, but this is the size of shredder we have in this kitchen, so this is what we're doing.
You gotta work with what you have, just like the knife. It's right. What you got. You make it work. I love the color, though, that the purple and the green.
It's very pretty.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is about a pound of vegetables, and so here's where we get into the salt ratios. This is also a difference of opinion. This is the ratio I tend to use, but you'll find all different sorts of stuff online if you could look into it. And if you want it to be less salty, like I said at the beginning, you don't have to use as much salt. But what you should do is, if you're not planning on using this salt ratio, I would look up a table online and like stick to some sort of ratio. Just because it makes things easier and it makes things a little bit more uniform in terms of how the ferment goes. So what I like to use is about 2 teaspoons, or more accurately 10 grams of salt per pound of vegetables. So that's where your little kitchen scale once again comes in handy, because then you can be super exact about that. So I have this little thing and I have it zeroed out. So I'm just gonna add, and this is just kosher salt, or iodized salt rather. You can use any type of salt. You can use sea salt if you want. You can use your Himalayan, whatever. You can use whatever you want, but I like the classic, just iodized baker salt. So yeah, we're just gonna get 10 grams in here. Or 11, that's fine. And then you have your bowl of veggies. You're gonna take this and you're just gonna sprinkle it over the veggies. And then you get to massage it. And this is gonna take you a long time, and it's gonna be kind of annoying. But basically you just get in here and start squishing the salt around, get it mixed in. You should use a bigger bowl than I'm using, because this is gonna be annoying too. Yeah, just get in there, and you want to kind of, it's almost like you're like trying to form bread dough a little bit. You're kind of kneading it, you're turning it around, you're getting it nice and like smashed up and squished up. And the goal here is, like I said, this is going to start releasing a ton of juice. And you're going to notice it's starting to release that liquid pretty soon, but here is where you're creating a brine, and the brine is what is like the vehicle for the fermentation almost. Mm-hmm. So you want enough brine for the cabbage and vegetables to be completely covered in the jar. So oftentimes this takes like about 10 minutes to do, or more even if you have a huge batch. The smaller your batch, the less time it takes, just because there's like less stuff that you have to move around with your hands. But it'll take about 10 minutes probably. And as much as I'm sure all of you want to watch me massage this cabbage for 10 minutes, I did prepare another batch so that you don't have to do that. So pretend I've done this for 10 minutes.
I remember doing this for the first time. I was doing it in a class, and it
takes a long time.
It's crazy how much juice comes out, though.
So this is where you're going to be at in about like 8 to 10 minutes. So you can see it's broken down quite a bit. This isn't even quite there yet. I'm going to do a little bit more. But what you notice is that when you pick up a thing, it's like
a sponge.
It's like pouring liquid out. So I'm going to just do this a little bit more. But this is pretty much there. You can keep going if you want, if you're like really want a broken down cabbage. You know, the main thing is that you're at that point where it's like really releasing a lot of juice, and that there's juice kind of collecting in the bottom of the bowl.
Mm-hmm.
That's the brine.
Oh, such beautiful juice.
And it's very purple, because I use cabbage. But yeah, this is pretty much there. I'm happy with this. So now is the point when I tend to add my spices. And some people, like I said, they'll add their spices at the very beginning of the process. I don't think it really matters that much. So I'm going to wash my hands really quick.
Mm-hmm. do another close-up of this fantastic stuff. It is crazy how much water it releases.
Okay, so spices, also something you can really play around with. It's good with garlic, it's good with ginger, it's good with, if you put like scallions in there, you can put in like, you can try and make it kind of spicy and put some chili powder in there. You can start like walking down the kimchi route a little bit more. But for this one, I'm just gonna do some classics, which is mustard seed and caraway seed. And this is like usually the sorts of spices you'll find in like your classic German sauerkraut. So I really like caraway seed.
Mm.
So I'm just gonna kind of go for it on that. I had one that was made with fennel seed once, and it was really good. Okay, so you've added those, you want to mix them around again, do kind of a final little mix and massage.
I will mention too that we've got three folks watching, and a hi to them. And if you guys have any questions at all, feel free to chime in. Or if you want Clare to show us something in particular or me to close up on something, let me know. I am watching the comments.
Okay, so we mixed in your stuff, and now it's time to pack the jar. I'm going to wash my hands again.
They're just so purple. Everything is purple.
Very purple for a while. Yeah, if you're doing this with purple cabbage.
Yeah, here are the spices.
Maybe do it on a weekend when you don't have to be anywhere. But, yeah, so now it's time to pack it. And first of all, I want to say that in order to do fermentation, you don't need any special equipment. And that was something that was kind of blocking me from doing it first, because I'm like, oh, I'm like, figure out all the stuff, I gotta buy stuff, whatever. You don't have to.
And picking out a crock can be kind of intense. There's a lot of opinions out there.
They're pretty expensive if you're going for like a fermentation crock, but you don't need it.
Mm-hmm.
What you need is a jar and something that fits inside the jar, like another jar. And that's like basically all you need. We have a really big jar here. I do it oftentimes in these quart size mason jars, just when I'm doing like smaller batches, because mm-hmm. I mean, I don't usually have enough people to share a gallon or half gallon sized of sauerkraut with, but yeah, so these work fine. This size is great. You don't need any special equipment, you just need a jar. So what you're going to do is, you're going to pack, actually let me grab one. You're going to take this stuff and you're going to put it in the jar, shockingly. And this is going to probably, this is not going to fill this big jar, but that's fine. You definitely want space at the top, so if you have a lot that you're making, I would go for a bigger jar rather than a smaller jar. Don't pack any jars like to the top.
And they are eventually going to put it in the refrigerator to stop the fermentation, right? So it needs to be able to fit in your fridge.
It also needs to be able to fit in your fridge. And then you want to like pack it down pretty significantly. Like you don't want it to be loose in there. You want it pretty packed down. So I usually just go in with my fridge. Hand again and squish it down in there. And then this is all the leftover juice at the bottom. So you're gonna pour all that in. And we're doing pretty good. So you can see the juice is pretty much at the top. We want it to be like above the top of the vegetables. So if you don't have quite enough brine, you can add a little bit of water. This might be a like controversial opinion too, but I always feel like I can add a little bit of water and I never really have any problems with it. So I'm just gonna do that. I'm not talking like a huge amount of water.
Right.
But you know, enough to.
The idea being you don't wanna set the salt ratio off too much.
Right.
Probably. Could you add more salt
you can add more
if
salt.
You needed to?
If I had a ton of water, I would add more salt. But, you know, I'm feeling good about that. That wasn't good
yeah.
water. And as you can see, when you press it, when it's pressed down, there's it's covered with the juice. And this juice is going to increase as the stuff breaks down in there.
Yeah.
So,
that looks great.
Where we're going back to the beginning with your cabbage leaf. That you tried to keep intact as you were cleaning your cabbage off. I like to put this in here and just use it to kind of cap almost. Well, yeah. Use it to kind of cap the situation so that you don't want like little pieces of cabbage floating up really, because the stuff that isn't submerged in the water is gonna have a higher likelihood of like getting moldy or rotting or getting
right.
weird. So I like to use a bigger cabbage leaf just to kind of like lay over the top of everything and hold everything down, and that also helps weigh it down a little bit, so you can kind of see it, what I'm talking about. It's just like laid down in there.
Yeah, let me get over the top. Make sure it's in focus. Yeah, you can see the edges of the leaves right around that top.
Yeah.
Capping it in there.
Then you need some sort of weight to hold all this down. And so here's where you might think you need special equipment, but you don't. So there are these things called fermentation lights. These are what some of them look like. Sometimes they're ceramic like this. Sometimes they're just like a glass, almost like a jar lid that you pull on and off with a little handle. There's a lot of different ones, and you can get these. They're not like expensive, certainly. You can get them online. You can get them at a good food store. You can get them at Summer Sun. But you can also, if you don't want to do that, you can get a jar, a clean jar, that fits inside of your jar. So not that. Or that.
Yeah, mugs sometimes work.
Yeah, like any sort of glass. I'll use this. And what I like to do is weigh it down a little bit with just like some pebbles that you've washed. I don't have any in here right now. But you basically just set it in. And you see how it pushes things down and keeps things held down. And that does the exact same thing as a fermentation weight just as well.
Sometimes better, probably,
sometimes
huh?
I actually brought this one because I was thinking I was going to have to use one of these small jars until Genevieve found this big one. So you can imagine this just kind of like way down with rocks sitting right about here and pushing all of that stuff down. So that is perfectly fine. It works great. You don't need fermentation weights. Because I have this bigger jar and none of these jars quite work right, I am going to use these fermentation weights. Wash it off.
And it is important to start with everything pretty clean just so the bad bacteria don't get introduced. Although it's amazing how much salt seems to make a difference.
You know, people who are like, oh, I don't want to use that much salt. The salt's there for a reason. Bad bacteria doesn't like salt. Good bacteria will feed off of it. And, you know, there's a reason why brine works as a preservation unit. So, there's my weights. You can see they're holding down that piece of cabbage leaf pretty well. And, yeah. So next up, we're talking sealing it, and there are a couple other things to go with that. Again, this is another thing where people will be like, oh, you need special equipment, but again, you don't. You might have seen these before. This is like fermenting, it's creating a lot of gas. And so if you have a lid on this like super tight and you're not letting any of that gas release, the pressure is building up and building up and building up. And you can have like, don't let this stop you from doing fermentation because this scared me a lot, but you can have like a minor jar explosion. So really not paying attention. So this and like a specified fermentation lid like this will help prevent that, because basically this goes in here, the lid goes on top, and as it's releasing gas, it goes into this.
And so cool.
This thing, and this like releases the pressure. So you don't have to be like militant about checking it every day. However, I didn't have one of these until like this year, and I've been doing this stuff for a while, so it's very easy and it's totally fine to just use a normal jar lid. So if you are using a mason jar like this and you have a lid like this, that's fine. All you gotta do, put it on, screw it on loosely, don't like, you know, tighten it up, just have it kind of screwed on loosely, and then that means that if you do forget to like look at it or deal with it for a day or two, there's a little bit of wiggle room and it's not gonna like
explode.
But all you have to do, you should be checking this stuff. It should be on your counter where you can see it anyway. So all you have to do is just burp the lid once a day, which, you know, just like release the air, take the lid off for a sec, or just even loosen the lid and release any bullet with pressure. And that works totally fine. You don't need one of these fancy things. And yeah, I only have one, so I oftentimes still just use normal jar lids and just remember to, yeah, release the pressure every day. But if you do have one of these and you want to use it, they're nice. This just fits like right in and has a nice seal on it. And then this sits right on top. And that's that. But like I said, you're going to put it on your counter probably. It does want to ferment at room temperature. So you're going to want to put it on your counter and you're going to want to keep an eye on it, because you'll notice sometimes a film develops, sometimes like some white gunk develops, sometimes it'll be like kind of frothy or foamy or bubbly, and sometimes you will get a little layer of mold on the top. And if you see that, don't freak out. Just open up your jar, scrape the mold off the top, and anything that's underneath the brine should still be fine. So like everything under your big cabbage essentially should be totally fine. There might be some little floaties, like you can see I already have a few little floaties that have come up. And those you can just scrape off with the mold or with whatever gunk is growing on it, and throw them away, and everything else should be totally fine. And this can ferment from, I mean, it all depends on your taste. If this is your first time making sauerkraut, I would probably open it up and give it a taste at like a week to 10 days. I usually start opening it up around then. I don't like super strong sauerkraut, so I'll probably start eating it at like the 2 week mark. There's people who will leave it as long as like 4 to 5 weeks, and then it's like super funky and sour. You want to keep an eye on it. You want to be tasting it every couple days at a certain point, and then once you decide it's like at your taste and you want to eat the rest of it at that sort of sourness level, then you can just move it to your fridge. Take this thing off, put a normal jar lid on it if you're using that. Take the weights out, take the cabbage leaf out, and put it in your fridge. And it will still be fermenting, but it's at a much, much, much lower rate. So like you can have it hanging out in your fridge for a couple months, and you shouldn't notice any difference. You can have it hanging out in your fridge for like a year and you'll notice a difference, but it's probably still edible. But yeah, so I think the most important thing about fermentation is that it's not something that you just like finish cooking, you're finished making, and then just like forget about until it's ready. You kind of have to be like an active part of the process and keep an eye on it, test it, taste it. That's part of the fun too, because if you're doing that, you're kind of figuring out how it all works and like watching that process happen. So, yeah.
Cool.
This is your finished product. Leave it out on the counter. Keep an eye on it. And then have German beer and some bratwurst.
Yum. Well, thank you so much, Clare. This is amazing. And I feel like much more comfortable with the whole process. As long as you get the salt ratio, seems like you're pretty good. And check it.
And keep checking it. I think that's honestly the most important thing is don't abandon it, don't forget about it, keep checking it.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Very cool. I'm going to swing the camera back to me. Thank you so much. And I'm just going to remind folks, sorry about the wiggly camera. I had a fly attacking me at the end. but we will be having a veggie sale the 16th and 17th, which is 2 weeks after CSA is over. You skip a week and then you can come back at River Road Farm if you want to join us. That would be fantastic. You can get all sorts of cabbage along with, there comes the fly again, along with lots of other veggies, even salad mix, but things also like carrots and potatoes that you can store all winter long and keep it local for the winter. So we even have, I think, 40-pound bags of onions. And you know, you can use your onions in almost everything, right? So you need 40 pounds for the winter. But hopefully you'll join us for that. And we also have the pumpkin party. You can come buy pumpkins at the Pease Farm, carve them right on the spot, skip the mess at home, and see your friends. So you can also check out that. That is on the 12th. It's a Saturday, the 12th of October. And you guys, we're going to miss you this summer, or this I should say fall. Now that the summer is over, we're going to miss you. We only have one more week after this one, so it's a bittersweet time of year. But enjoy your veggies, and we'll see you guys next week.